All my days, I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake,
I'm really glad he's, yeah.
Till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness.
Hey, good morning, NEHBC. It is really good to see you. We're going to start this morning singing together, so would you stand as we sing?
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin, your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began.
Oh, your grace.
Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. To my dead, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins. Your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost.
But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. And that's when death was arrested and my life began.
Sing that again.
That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your song of all the redeemed. We're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began, when death was arrested and my life began, that's when death was arrested and my life began.
Dry, drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
I love that we get to sing about and celebrate the simplicity of the gospel, that it is available to every single one of us.
Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. See his open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved the world.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him for the wonders of his love. Praise God, praise God.
The world that he gave us one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom, for God so loved.
Please be seated.
Good morning, church family. It's good to be with you. It's my joy to welcome you this morning. My name is Justin Graham. I'm one of the pastors here. And on behalf of all the pastors, I just want to welcome you. Thank you for coming to worship with us. It's always a joy and a gift that God allows us to gather as His body, as His family, to meet with Him and to meet with one another. If you're a guest with us this morning, I want to just say a special welcome to you. We're glad you're here, and we want to get to know you. So at the end of the service, whenever they pass the green bags through your row, if you'll grab that communication card that you received whenever you walked in, fill that out, drop that in the bag. That'll be your gift to us this morning, so we can follow up with you and get to know about you and help you find a place to belong and make NEHBC just your home and your family in Christ. So we'd love to do that for you. I also want to just say happy Mother's Day. I know we have been gifted by God with many godly, faithful women and moms in this church, and we're thankful for you. I know Mother's Day can also be a day with just a flurry of different emotions, a day of celebration and joy, and at the same time can be a day of sorrow and pain, either for moms who are no longer with us, or those who are desiring and praying and seeking to become a mom and just have not been able to, or a strained relationship with mom. There's a lot of reasons that this can have a mix of emotions that come with it, but I just want you to know, whatever your circumstances and whatever your particular mix of emotions on Mother's Day, God sees you, He loves you, cares deeply about you. I'm just reminded of Genesis 16 as Hagar is fleeing and running in the wilderness, and God meets her there, and she refers to Him as El Roy, the God who sees, right? God sees you in your situation. He sees you in the faithful service and parenting that no one else sees, or maybe gives you thanks for. He sees you there. He sees you in the praying and the waiting. He sees you in just the caring and the love that you give to your kids, and we see you, and we love you, moms. So as we move on just in our service, one of the beautiful truths and realities of these times that we gather together as a church family, though, is that regardless of whatever your story is, your circumstances, what's going on in your life, we're here to lift our eyes above the circumstances, above whatever's happening right in front of us, to the one who stands before all things and above all things, and who is the Alpha, the Omega, and to exalt the name of Jesus Christ in this place, and to lift our eyes to Him, because our hope is found in Him. His grace is sufficient for us in whatever it is that we're facing, and He's the one that we're here to meet with and to sing to. And to hear from through His word. And so as we continue in worship, we're going to enter into a time of prayer. And so just ask you to join me just in a posture of prayer, whatever that looks like. The altar is open at the front. You can stay in your seat. You can stand, whatever that looks like for you. But join me now as we pray together. Father, we are so grateful, Lord, for Your faithfulness, Lord, for Your kindness to us, for all of the ways that You have provided for us, most of all through Your Son. Lord, when we were separated from You, when we were far from You, hostile toward You, You pursued after us in Your love. demonstrated your love and that while we were yet sinners, Jesus, you died for us. And we're thankful. We're thankful, Lord. And we're thankful as well for our moms. Lord, especially those that are walking closely with you and have set an example and have taught us and cared for us and encouraged us in our walk. I'm just reminded of Timothy from the New Testament, who says that his faith was rooted and grounded in the faith of his mother and his grandmother. Like, those were the influences, Lord, that shaped him, formed him spiritually. And so, Lord, we're thankful, Lord, for the godly mothers that you have placed in our lives to point us to you. And Lord, we're also thankful that you are a God of all comfort. You tell us in 2 Corinthians 1, Lord, so that you comfort us in our afflictions, that we would comfort others in their afflictions, Lord, that you have peace that surpasses all understanding, Lord, when we bring our requests and make them known to you. And so, Father, we thank you for that, Lord, that for every pain, every sorrow, every difficulty that we face, your grace is sufficient. Just reminded of the quote that there is no pit so deep that the love of God is not deeper still. And so we praise you for that truth, Lord, that wherever we are, Lord, whatever we brought into us, brought in with us, Lord, to this morning, Lord, you're able to carry it. You desire to carry it, Lord, to bear the burdens that we have. And so, Father, just ask, Lord, that in a unique and a personal way, Lord, that you would just minister to the heart of every person that walked into this room this morning, moms especially, but Lord, for all of us. Lord, that we would lift our eyes to you as the God who is great and mighty and powerful. Nothing is too difficult for you. The thing that seems most impossible or most insurmountable in our lives is easy to you. So, Father, would we take our burdens and our cares and lay them at your feet? And Father, also just be reminded of the height and the depth and the breadth and the width of your love for us, Lord, that you're not only mighty in power to be able to carry our burdens, but you love us and you desire to carry our burdens. And so, Father, would we just be found faithful this morning to bring them to you, to submit them at your feet, to trust you with them. And Father, I do just want to pray as well, Lord, in these approaching last weeks of May, as schools are wrapping up for the spring, Lord, that as students are facing final exams, as teachers and faculty and staff and administrators are closing out all of their responsibilities for the year and preparing for the summer, Lord, that Lord, you would enable them by your Spirit, Lord, to finish well, to finish strong. Lord, that you would give them just an extra measure of energy, grace, patience, as I know students get restless at this time of year. But Father, I just ask that you would see them through the finish line, and that there would just be sweet, refreshing rest waiting on the other side, Lord, as you prepare them for a new year, Lord, a new season of teaching, a new season of leading in our schools. And Father, just lift them up to you, Lord, all of the elementary, the middle, the high schools, for those that homeschool, Lord, in all ways related to school, just lift that to you and trust, Lord, for your wisdom, Lord, your guidance, and Lord, and ultimately your Spirit to be at work, not just as we learn information, but that we would learn the truth, be transformed in our hearts, Lord, by the truth that matters most. Lord, and that it would actually become wisdom that shapes and guides and forms our lives, that we would live rightly in a way that's pleasing to you as we learn. So, Father, as we continue in worship, Lord, we just ask that, Lord, that you, Jesus, would be exalted in this place, that all else would fade to the background of our hearts and our minds, distractions would be removed, you'd calm our hearts so that we could focus on you, on your word, on what you have to say to us this morning. I just ask that our ears would be open, our hearts would be responsive, and our lives would be impacted deeply and lastingly from what you accomplished in this place today. So we love you, Jesus, and we pray this in your name. Amen.
Would you stand as we continue to sing together?
Spirit, our God is three in one. I
believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
From heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes, to fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
Would you please be seated?
I invite you to open to 1 Kings chapter 21 this morning. 1 Kings chapter 21. And as you're turning there, if we had a title for this morning's sermon, it would be A Righteous Suffering and Surrender. Happy Mother's Day. A Righteous Suffering and Surrender. And some of you are probably thinking, yeah, Pastor, what a perfect Mother's Day title. I am all too familiar with this righteous pursuit of suffering and surrender, all in the name of motherhood. My bride of almost 16 years is getting a little extra dose and extra experience of motherhood this morning because we were gifted, you know, at 4:52 this morning, the creaking noise of an upstairs door was opening. And as a parent, you're like trying to, as quickly as possible, identify, okay, was that a door opening? Which kid is it? Okay, it's the youngest, our almost four-year-old little baby Judah. He's coming out of his door and he's kind of whimpering. Okay, is it a serious whimper or is it just like, hey, it's okay, let me take you to go in bed with mama and you're going to be okay because I'm up trying to make sure I'm good for this morning. Well, he proceeds to cross the walk upstairs and it's not sounding very good. The whimpering is growing. And then there at the top step of the stairs, he begins to cough a little bit. And it's not that type of dry cough where it's like, oh, it's this some type of sore throat or something. Let me get you a drink of water, a glass of milk, put you back down. This was a congested, moist cough that was guaranteeing something physical and moist to follow upward in direction, if you catch my drift. About the time he said, my stomach hurts, it all came out from the stop stair of the steps. And if you physics scientists, enthusiasts are wondering, yes, gravity took full effect. Suffering, surrendering for the righteous pursuit of parenting. In all sincerity, I know we all have a familiarity, if we're blessed with the gift of parenting, of pursuing righteousness, and there's different elements of suffering and different elements of surrender. And as Pastor Justin mentioned and prayed so well earlier, there's also different levels and extremities of that. Some of you are gathered in this capacity today with the highest of celebrations, all things mom. Some of you are gathered with a heaviness because you're just still desperately seeking the Lord, hoping to enjoy the spoils of parenthood one day. And others of you are gathered in this capacity, seeking the Lord, and you know the suffering and the surrendering of parenthood because you're a mother or a father who your son or your daughter has already passed, and you're trying to just seek the Lord in righteousness without them physically being here. Suffering and surrender and our pursuits of righteousness as children of the Lord are very real. And as comical as it might be, thinking about how my bride experienced that this morning, or wherever you might be on that range of emotions, it's a truth for every aspect of our following the one true God. In our following of the one true God, we are called to suffer for righteousness as well as surrender to it. We are called to suffer for righteousness and surrender to it. And this morning, as we go to 1 Kings 21, continuing in the life and ministry of Elijah, and hang in there in verse 17, he's going to re-enter the scene. Whoop, whoop, let's go. It is good. But to begin with, I'm going to read the first 16 verses. We're going to go through the entire chapter, but I'm going to read the first 16 verses, and we're going to be looking at the heart of this text that is just what I said. In our following of the one true God, we are called to suffer for righteousness as well as surrender to it. This is what the Word of God says, chapter 21. Now Naboth the Jezreelite had a vineyard in Jezreel beside the palace of Ahab, king of Samaria. And after this, Ahab said to Naboth, give me your vineyard that I may have it for a vegetable garden, because it's near my house, and I'll give you a better vineyard for it. Or if it seems good to you, I'll give you its value in money. But Naboth said to Ahab, "The Lord forbid that I should give you the inheritance of my fathers." And Ahab went into his house, vexed and sullen because of what Naboth the Jezreelite had said to him. For he had said, "I will not give you the inheritance of my fathers." And he lay down on his bed, and he turned away his face and would eat no food. But Jezebel, his wife, came to him and said to him, "Why is your spirit so vexed that you eat no food?" And he said to her, "Because I spoke to Naboth the Jezreelite and said to him, 'Give me your vineyard for money, or else, if it please you, I'll give you another vineyard for it.' And he answered, 'I will not give you my vineyard.'" And Jezebel, his wife, said to him, "Do you now govern Israel? Arise and eat bread and let your heart be cheerful. I will give you the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite." So she wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed them with his seal. And she sent the letters to the elders and the leaders who lived with Naboth in his city. And she wrote in the letters, "Proclaim a fast. Set Naboth at the head of the people and set two worthless men opposite him. And let them bring a charge against him, saying, 'You have cursed God and the king.' Then take him out and stone him to death." And the men of his city, the elders and the leaders who lived in the city, did as Jezebel had sent word to them, as it was written in the letters that she had sent to them. They proclaimed a fast, set Naboth at the head of the people, and the two worthless men came in, sat opposite him. The worthless men brought a charge against Naboth in the presence of the people, saying, "Naboth cursed God and the king." So they took him outside the city and stoned him to death with stones. Then they sent to Jezebel, saying, "Naboth has been stoned, he is dead." As soon as Jezebel heard that Naboth had been stoned and was dead, Jezebel said to Ahab, "Arise, take possession of the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite, which he refused to give you for money, for Naboth is not alive but dead." And as soon as Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, Ahab arose to go down to the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite to take possession of it. After having some difficult years, things are now going pretty well for King Ahab. Remember, he survived a 3.5-year drought. He survived the troubler of Israel, Elijah, and the fire that fell from heaven. Most recently, he survived a couple rounds of battle with Syria and 32 other kings who had come alongside Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria. Although Ahab, as you remember, he didn't close things out exactly how God had desired, but nonetheless, Ahab figured a way out. He survived, and he improved his worldly relations with Syria. And now, as the first four verses mention, he's spending more time in what was known as his summer home in Jezreel. The capital of the northern kingdom was in Samaria, but here in the Jezreel Valley was the summer palace of King Ahab and Jezebel. And they took interest in this neighboring vineyard owned by Naboth, or in the Hebrew transliteration or alliteration, Naboth. Naboth. I'm going to say Naboth. It's easier. If I interchange it, it's not intentional. There's nothing spiritual about it. We're going with Naboth. The location would have been with breathtaking views toward the northeast overlooking Syria. And as you let that scenario set place in your mind's eye, it sets the stage as this reminder that King Ahab, regardless of everything he's been through, everything he has personally experienced and witnessed, he's continuing to set the trajectory of his pursuits toward a stronger association with the world, a stronger connection with Syria, which in turn means a greater distance, a stronger disassociation with the Lord. He's got his eyes fixed on this vineyard, and he wants it. And apparently, he's in the business of flipping real estate. Like, just as I was worshiping, I tried to get not too sidetracked, but there's a show on HGTV, and I should have done some homework, but I didn't think about it until now. There's a show on HGTV, Flipping the Homes. It used to be one couple with a blonde-haired mom. They have since divorced, and he has remarried someone who looks almost just like her. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? Maybe her real name is Jezebel. I don't know. Ahab is in the business here of flipping real estate here. And he's like, "Hey, Naboth, you've got this vineyard. It butts right up to my summer home. It would be perfect in me growing closer to the Syrians. And hey, I'll give you a great deal. I'm going to take it, and I'm going to transform your vineyard into a vegetable garden. Pause right there. Who does that? Who says, I'm going to take grapes, and instead of grapes, you go to lunch today and you say, hey, child, the majority of you, I know there's some exceptions, y'all are awesome, but the majority of children, would you like grapes or broccoli as the side of your kid's meal? What are you choosing? Okay, you're the exception. I knew we'd get it. Carry on. Nothing to see here. You're going to choose grapes, okay? Nobody says, oh, look at these grapes. Look at the land flowing with milk and honey. I'm going to transform it into a vegetable garden. Nobody does that. Ahab did. He literally took the land that God promised, flowing with grapes, milk, and honey, and was setting his mind and his heart toward doing anything he possibly could to undo all God desired, even transforming into a vegetable garden. It tells us, I won't read it, but in Deuteronomy chapter 11, verses 10 to 12, you can look at it later. When this Israelite, Naboth, heard that his vineyard was going to be taken and then transformed into a vegetable garden, that caused him to become unsettled. Not because the Israelites didn't like vegetables, but because what it represented. And Deuteronomy tells us, the vegetable gardens are representative of life as a slave under the Egyptian rulers. God said, I'm promising you a land of milk and honey. I'm promising you land under the care of my grace. No longer these vegetable gardens that you've known under the Egyptians. But Ahab is still doing all he can to unturn all God had accomplished and desired. So Naboth, this Israelite, he responds to King Ahab in verse 3, and he says, no. But notice the heart behind it. He's not just asserting some type of free market rights of refusal. He's not just responding and saying, hey, this has been in my family for generations. It means too much to me and my family. I can't let it go to someone, even you, King. That wasn't it. This was a legitimate declaration of Naboth's commitment to righteousness. Even if it was refusing the king. Knowing if you are going to be the agent that refuses and frustrates the king and his resources, there is coming inevitable suffering in your life. He didn't just say no. He put a yes on the table saying, I'm more declared allegiance to the one true God, even though your offer is very attractive. I mean, it was very attractive. King Ahab said, hey, even if that's not what you want to do, I'll give you money. I'll give you enough to make a profit out of this. Naboth could have sold his property at a premium. He could have made a killing. There's a reason between the real estate, not knowing who's purchasing your home. That way you can't leverage or expose it or exploit the potential buyer. He knew the king wanted to buy his property. He could have exploited the king for his resources and made a killing. So at a minimum, in the eyes of the world, Naboth had a commitment to righteousness, even if it meant suffering profit margins. He was committed to following the one true God. But here's the ultimate heart behind it. This vineyard that Naboth had, it had been in his family for generations, yes, but only because the Lord had gifted it first to his family. You can go throughout the Old Testament when the Lord gave the promised land to the Israelites. His desire for the promised land was to be a place where his presence and glory dwelled among his people as a beacon of hope for all neighboring nations. And in part of that was dividing and assigning the land to families and tribes. This land, this vineyard Naboth had, was the portion of land allotted to his family by the Lord. And he was commanded to never give it up. So it wasn't a no, it was a my yes is still to the one true God, even if my pursuit of righteousness will bring inevitable suffering my way. Naboth was clinging to all that was righteous, like Paul says in Romans chapter 12, verse 9. Let love be genuine. Detest evil. Hold fast to what is good. Naboth was clinging to all that was righteous, even though he knew it would highly frustrate the king and subsequently destroy his own life. His response did frustrate the king, to say the least. And King Ahab goes home, and he does what we've seen him do before. He goes home, and he mopes. He bemoans to Jezebel. He tells Jezebel what Naboth told him. Not exactly, though, right? Are you with me there? Naboth told King Ahab, "No, I will not give you what is my inheritance." Naboth never said, "I will not give you my land." Naboth never claimed this land to be his. He only and always recognized the land as a gift from the Lord. But Ahab, never letting facts get in the way of a good story to his wife Jezebel, said, "You won't believe what Naboth told me. I offered to buy his vineyard, I offered to flip it, I offered to give him greater margin, a profit than he really deserved." And he said, "No, you're not buying my land." That's not at all what Naboth said. And here's a classic example of bad things that happen when adults choose to act like children. You ever see that play out in the real world today? Wow. We tell our kids and our sports teams all the time, it's never good when adult chooses to act like children. We see it on the sports field. We see it in the rush hour traffic. We see it in our neighborly communities right here in Atascocita. And we've seen Ahab play this out a number of times. Ultimately, quickly, what it does, above all, yeah, he's an adult acting like a child, but it exposes his heart. It exposes a discontentment. It exposes covetousness. It exposes a lack of desire to follow the one true God and instead follow whatever affections and appetites of his own flesh. For Ahab, he wasn't content with the providence of God. So he moped back to Jezebel, refused to eat his food. And there's a lesson here for us. And I just want to kind of broach it here. And Lord willing, we'll bring it back at the end for an impact in your following of Jesus. The lesson is this. In the heart of the disciple, there's a deep trust that God is in control. While things may not be going great, you can keep going. While things may not make sense, you can trust him instead of throwing a fit and not eating your dinner. Ahab's heart was exposed. He was not content. So Jezebel, as it plays out, she appeals to Ahab's ego. "Aren't you the ruling authority for Israel? Aren't you the one who just conquered the Syrian armies in not just one battle, but two battles?" And she provides this twisted, evil, schemed encouragement. This wife, seeking to take that which does not belong to her and offer it to her husband. Flashbacks Garden of Eden, right? Eve taking the forbidden fruit, offering it to her husband. And what did he do? He was docile. He was passive. He said, "Okay." He was a loser spiritually. You go back in the account of Genesis. It shows Satan the serpent speaking to Eve. And us men like the joke that, oh, well, he was speaking to Eve, so Adam must not have been there. We'll make some lame joke about ladies. But when you dig into the Hebrew and you get real about the text as God's word, you see there's this masculine plural in which Satan addresses Eve. And it's not because she's transgender. It's because Adam, her husband with no spiritual backbone, is right there listening to the conversation the entire time. And when she gives in to the temptation of Satan, when she takes the forbidden fruit and offers it to him, he welcomes it gladly. And here are the same things playing out with Ahab and Jezebel. And he takes her offer, so he sits back, he stays home, and she puts her plan of forbidden fruit into motion. So the story continues, verses 8 to 14. Jezebel's plan, she gets some falsified letters. That's a great place to start. She falsifies letters, signs off as the king. Then she decrees some type of prayer and fasting of the people there in Jezreel. Then she has these fabricated accusations. She brings in two worthless men as witnesses. And it all results in the fatality of the faithful Naboth. That's her plan. Did you notice everything masked in religion? It's in the name of the anointed king of Israel. It's in the name of praying and fasting. It's in the name of two witnesses according to the law of the Lord. When God is cursed, bring two witnesses. And should they agree that God and the king have been cursed, the punishment is stoning to death. Naboth loses his life. He suffered for the sake of righteousness. And scripture says in verses 15 and 16, we just read, as soon as Jezebel heard that Naboth had been stoned and was dead, she said to Ahab, arise, take possession of the vineyard. He refused to give you for money, but he is not alive, he is dead. And as soon as Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, Ahab arose to go down to the vineyard of Naboth, the Jezreelite, to take possession of it. And not only did Naboth lose his life in his pursuit of righteousness, his commitment to righteousness, but if you go further in 2 Kings chapter 9, you'll see that his sons were murdered as well. The pursuit of righteousness and following the one true God is a guaranteed path of suffering. Naboth was willing to accept that. He was committed to righteousness, even if it meant his own suffering. And in this case, it cost him his life. And at this point, we come to verse 17. And I don't know about y'all, and I guess my flesh doesn't halfway care. I personally am ready for the judgment of Ahab. Amen? I'm ready to drag him into the town center, make a spectacle of him, carry out the full extent of the law, and render judgment. And perhaps for you, as you think through this story, maybe different examples of injustices come to mind. Maybe some things you've experienced in your own life that were just unjust, and you think, man, someone deserves judgment. When is it going to happen? Or maybe things you've seen play out around you. And rightly so, you're longing to see justice. And you long to see the perpetrator get what he or she deserves. And we come to chapter 2, verse 17. As promised, re-enter Elijah. Verses 17 to 24. He comes back on the scene. And basically what it sounds like is, Ahab, your time is up. Here's how it played out. The word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, arise, go down and meet Ahab, king of Israel, who's in Samaria. Behold, he's in the vineyard. Which vineyard? Of Naboth, which, understandably so, is ultimately the Lord's vineyard, where he's gone to take possession. You shall say to him, thus says the Lord, have you killed and also taken possession? You shall say to him, thus says the Lord, in the place where dogs licked up the blood of Naboth, shall dogs lick your own blood. Ahab said to Elijah, have you found me, O my enemy? Remember other times he's been like, oh, is it you, you troubler of Israel? Now it's as personal as it gets. O Elijah the Tishbite, have you now found me, my enemy? Elijah answered, I have found you. Because you sold yourself to do what is evil in the sight of the Lord. Behold, I will bring disaster upon you. I will utterly burn you up and will cut off from Ahab every male, bond or free in Israel. I'll make your house like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, like the house of Baasha, the son of Ahijah, for the anger to which you have provoked me and because you made Israel to sin. And if Jezebel, the Lord also said, the dog shall eat Jezebel within the walls of Jezreel. Anyone belonging to Ahab who dies in the city, the dogs shall eat. And anyone of his who dies in the open country, the birds of the heavens shall eat. Let judgment reign. Let justice be administered. Amen? About time. Thank you, Lord. Come on. But as you might know, I'm setting you up, ain't I? Not so fast, right? Vengeance is the Lord's, not ours. Judgment is from him. His glory, Isaiah 42 says, he shares with no one. And I say that realizing Ahab is so deserving. I say that realizing Jezebel was so deserving. But not so fast, for as evil and deserving of wrath they both were. Look at verses 25 and 26. It even doubles down with this parenthetical explanation. There is none who sold himself to do what was evil in the sight of the Lord like Ahab, whom Jezebel, his wife, incited. He acted very abominably in going after idols as the Amorites had done, whom the Lord cast out before the people of Israel. That's just helping us as the reader. If you read through 17 and 24 and you thought, man, that sounds a little harsh. Scripture is just reminding you, this guy has transgressed the holy standard of God. He's provoked the Lord to anger and incited the people of Israel to sin against the holy God. He is deserving of God's wrath. But for as evil as he was, verses 27 to 29 show humility and show repentance on behalf of Ahab. Let me read this for you. Scripture has just devoted verses 17 to 26 to ensure we as readers recognize how vile, corrupt, and deserving of wrath Ahab and Jezebel are. But then the chapter finishes like this. And when Ahab heard those words, he tore his clothes and put sackcloth on his flesh and fasted and lay on sackcloth and went about dejectedly. And the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, have you seen how Ahab has humbled himself before me? Because he has humbled himself before me, I will not bring the disaster in his days, but in his son's days I will bring the disaster upon his house. Humility, repentance, at least a momentary surrender that is genuine enough, at least in this moment, where God speaks to Elijah and says, have you noticed his humility and repentance? As a result, even though he is so deserving of my wrath, I will extend a little more grace. I shared some of this with you last week as the story played out. Remember earlier how Ahab's heart was exposed and how he responded to Naboth's rejection? Like he was discontent. He saw how Naboth responded, and it didn't sit well with him. When I see how Ahab responded, even in humility and repentance, at first it doesn't sit well with me. And the Lord says, okay, Prophet Elijah, tell him I'm going to be gracious with him. So the apparent question from Scripture is this. What does your response to Ahab's repentance reveal about your own heart? What does your response, your disposition toward Ahab's repentance reveal about your own heart and spirituality? The heart of a disciple is deep trust in God, that he's in control. So in our following of the one true God, we're called to this sweet surrender to righteousness, God's holy standard of providence and grace and justice, however he so chooses to extend those. It's his, not ours. We're called to this sweet surrender to righteousness, even when it doesn't seem fitting. Eventually, the punishment of death does come to both Jezebel and Ahab. And it's quite epic. You're like, whoa, you've talked about these dogs and these birds. It's more epic than that? Yeah, I think so. And we'll get to it. But at least in this moment, there's some level or type of repentance that God honors. How does that sit with you? Are you able to trust God with it and surrender your own disposition? When I'm convinced, as we talk about, we're called to suffer for righteousness, we're also called to surrender to righteousness. I'm convinced this first one, we more easily receive it. Yeah, I'm called to the straight and narrow, and as I go counter to culture, I'm going to experience suffering. I'm going to suffer profit margins in the eyes of this world. I'm going to suffer broken relationships. I'm not going to get all this world offers me. I'm going to suffer because I'm following the straight and narrow path of righteousness. I think we're more ready and able to amen that truth, that we're called to suffer for righteousness. But when we're reminded that we're also called to surrender to whatever God's full-scoped redemptive righteousness is, especially when it doesn't seem fitting, we're not so ready and willing. What's your heart to the corrupt Ahabs and those around you in your own lives today? Is it revenge and their own ruin? Or are you desperately hoping for their redemption? As God the Father is. See, the remedy, especially on this Mother's Day, the remedy is looking at these through the eyes of a parent. Like, go back to 1 Kings 17 this week. Read through the narrative up to this point. And when you come up to the end of chapter 21, imagine yourself as the father or mother of King Ahab. Would you be cheering for his ruin or his redemption? And the Heavenly Father I know in Christ Jesus, for as long as there is still opportunity, is pursuing his redemption. And our following of the one true God, we're called to suffer for righteousness, yes, at all costs, just as Naboth gave his life, but we're also called to trust in a sweet surrendering to righteousness as well. We're called to suffer for righteousness as well as surrender to it, seek righteousness at all costs, but be willing to surrender our own agenda for God's redemptive purposes. And the reminder God's given me from this narrative is, I believe, a helpful reminder for you as well. We remember that Naboth was not the only man who was innocent yet falsely accused. Naboth wasn't the only innocent man ever falsely accused and then killed outside the city. Yet Naboth, in his brokenness, deserved death eventually. But we know one who was fully God, fully man, who knew no sin and became sin for you and me. He was falsely accused. He had worthless witnesses. He was accused of cursing the king and cursing God. And he hanged on a tree as a curse for you and for me. Our former debt of sin can now be credited with the fullness of his righteousness. It's that truth that compels us to follow him at all costs, especially in the suffering. It's that truth that remembering he died even for me, yours truly, a vilest of offenders, that also compels me to surrender my life to seek and save the lost. So I wonder today, how is God calling you to suffer and surrender in a righteous pursuit of Jesus? Maybe this Mother's Day, you've got a son or daughter on your mind and your heart that you've just been praying, God, would you save them? And maybe you came in just so broke. Maybe you came this morning and they wouldn't even give you the day to come to church with you today. And you're considering giving up on them. Maybe today, through God's word, you're just being called to continue to surrender your own feelings and emotions and keep praying for their salvation. When you think of injustices in your life, the most corrupt and vilest of offenders, so deserving of wrath, I'm convinced this morning God's word is calling us to pray for their redemption. So I'm going to pray for us, and we're going to have an opportunity to respond in song. We'll have pastors down here if you'd like someone to pray with you. Maybe you need to come down and have someone pray with you and understand what it looks like for your own redemption, your own personal relationship with Jesus. Or maybe as others are singing, you just need to come down to this open altar and pray for someone by name, surrendering your own agenda and saying, Lord, would you transform this person and give them a relationship with Jesus as Savior? So I want to invite you, friends, if you would stand at this time. I want to pray with us, pray for us. And we'll have an opportunity to respond one last time. Father God, we come to you right now. And we thank you that in Christ Jesus, there is nothing I can do, there is nothing we can say or do or think that will cause you to love us any less or any more because we are covered by the blood of Jesus. Thank you that you are our Heavenly Father. Lord, as we've looked back on the story of Ahab and Naboth, we're also reminded for how grateful we are for your pursuit of us when we were children of wrath. And Lord, for how that love compels us to live a life of righteousness and suffering at all costs, I ask that today you would help us surrender our agenda, especially in the areas of those who deserve wrath, and help us see them as sheep without a shepherd, and help us to have a broken heart for their salvation, and help us to lift them up to you in prayer. That you would arrest the death in their lives. Truly that a new life would begin in Christ. Holy Spirit, would you empower us? Would you grant us strength of heart? Would you give us the faith needed to respond obediently however you are prompting us during this time? We give it to you and we pray these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Oh, to Jesus I surrender. Oh, to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence.
Church family, at this time we continue in a spirit of worship by giving of our offering, tithes and offerings, financial first fruits in response to all of God has given us. We recognize we have nothing in our possession. There's no resource, and especially finances, that we have that is outside a gift from our Father in heaven. And so it's an opportunity for us to continue worshiping. I'm demonstrating a trust in the one true God as we give a first fruits of our finances, knowing full well, as we trust Him with a first fruits offering, He always does more for his glory in our lives with what we have remaining than if we kept 100% within our own strength. So I want to pray for this time. Our ushers are going to come forward, and then our green bags are going to be passed. If you're a guest, I want to encourage you as well. This is the time to put that communication card in our green bags. Father God, this is our offering to you. Ever so small, ever so limited. But we know nothing is outside of your provision. Nothing we have to steward is outside of you as Heavenly Father gifting it to us. So this is our way of declaring deeper trust in you, a greater love for you, and a stronger expectation to see you bless and multiply and advance your kingdom through these limiting means of worldly treasures. I ask that you would help us grow in our obedience during this time and holding tightly to you and loose to this world, and that you would be glorified. And we pray these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. As the bags are being passed, I want to share a few announcements. I've got three major items I want to share with you. One is our weekly prayer meeting every Tuesday, 7 p.m. We passionately seek the manifest presence of the Lord and a greater filling of the Holy Spirit every Tuesday evening, 7 p.m. right here. Part of our prayer gathering is a one-on-one prayer line where if you have a need, physical, mental, spiritual, financial, anything, you're invited to come get with a pastor or a ministry leader, and we can pray over you. Recently, we've been doing that before prayer meeting. This Tuesday, we are not doing any pre-prayer meeting one-on-one prayer line. We'll be incorporating that back into the main prayer time. And so one-on-one prayer is so powerful, carrying out the one another's. It will be during the actual time of prayer meeting. So if you've been with us recently or you're deciding to recommit this Tuesday, I just want you to know that. You are welcome to come as early as 6:30. The atmosphere here is already prepared where you can come in, open God's word, and just begin reflecting and allow the Lord to prepare your heart as we seek his presence. But just a reminder, prayer meeting 7 p.m. this Tuesday. I'm really looking forward to all God has in store this week. Also, as you'll notice in my hand, Get in the Game. We are in the Get in the Game season in our church family. We believe what Scripture teaches, so we practice it and we carry it out convictionally, that we are all vital members of the body of Christ. Some of you think that you're sitting on the sidelines and not serving is because you don't have anything significant to contribute, or you don't think it really impacts anybody other than yourself. That is wrong. Scripture teaches that everybody, young and old, seemingly insignificant and significant, have a critical role to play in the local bride. And so our Get in the Game season, it builds up to Sunday, June 4th, where we come in here, we wear our sports jersey. It's kind of childish to wear, you know, grown people wear jerseys and things like that, but it's exciting because we get pumped up for saying, I'm getting in the game of the local church to serve the bride at NEHBC. And so this booklet is a helpful tool for you to see all the opportunities to serve, to make it easy for you. Your job is to pray for clarity where to serve, not if you should serve. And I'm not saying that because I'm your pastor. I'm saying that because I believe all that Scripture teaches. It's not a matter of if you will serve, but if you're a member of NEHBC, God has called you to belong here. You are called to serve. And every year we set this up that you might seek the Lord and have clarity on where he wants you to serve for the next 12 months. Sound good? All right, thanks guys. All right, one final announcement, and I've got notes here so I don't mess it up. Last week, you might remember I mentioned some type of upcoming announcement of a new senior staff position. Hopefully it's generated a little buzz. Okay, today it is my joy, my excitement to have the privilege of introducing to you the new executive pastor at NEHBC. Praise the Lord. Yeah, we can praise the Lord. This is a good thing, guys. Listen, the way God has set up the local church, it's similar fashion of Adam and Eve. It's like a professional marriage. God provides the sub-shepherd of a senior pastor, the under-shepherd, and then a helpmate and the executive pastor to then go be fruitful and multiply for kingdom purposes. And for 5 months now, your under-shepherd has been operating without a helpmate on staff. Does that make sense in a weird way? So God has gifted this new pastor in this role that I'm going to introduce you in just a moment. But I need to say some things very quickly. So please, wait till I get through it, and then we will celebrate this good thing. All right, here we go. When I came on board as senior pastor, not only had our church family gone during a time of no senior pastor, but also no executive pastor as well. And so we were going through this transition for a church our size, and especially all God has called us to. The role of an executive pastor is critical. Since I've been here for 5 months, something God has quickly shown me, as well as our other four trustees, is that hiring an executive pastor externally would almost be near disaster. It would not be helpful. I've only been with you for 5 months. So it would be a new senior pastor and then someone from outside of our church coming in, two guys not really knowing as long of a history. Does that make sense? So then it came to the point of prayer. Lord, you've called us to have an XP, but not externally. So you're going to have to provide some kind of miraculous movement here because we don't know what you're putting together here. So through much prayer and seeking the Lord, he equally has shown us in undeniable fashion that he's already gifted us with someone internally among our own at NEHBC that we can hire as an executive pastor. I wrote this down because I mean it, and I want to make sure I say it correctly. This brother has become a dear friend of mine. He loves me deeply, my family deeply. He loves Jesus deeply and the church. It all comes out of his personal love for Jesus and his own love for his bride, his helpmate at home. He's actually been operating this in an unofficial capacity for the last 6 months. It's abundantly obvious how God has gifted him for such a position as this. He became a Christian and was baptized at the Hamptons Christian and Missionary Alliance in the church in Watermill, New York. He has a degree in network administration. He was the IT director for a nearby school district. He was instrumental, and that is an understatement, in leading our staff during the senior pastor transition. He has coordinated all of our Christmas Eve and Easter services over the last 18 months. He's been a member of NEHBC since 2014. He married his lovely bride in 2019, and he also began in 19 as our associate pastor of music and communications. I proudly introduce to you our executive pastor, Daryl Cheney, and his wife, Jen. Woo! I love you, man. Guys, this is a good thing. He is a gift to the local bride, so praise the Lord. At this time, our trustees and our staff with our spouses, if you would come gather around Pastor Daryl and his wife, Jen, and one of our trustees, Scott, is going to say a prayer over them. And so if you would just remain standing as Scott prays us out over Pastor Daryl and his wife, Jen, this will be our dismissal as well.
Gratitude and thankfulness in our hearts to you for all you have done for us, Father. As we heard, the last year, Father, has been a journey. Father, where we saw a previous senior pastor and executive pastor called away, and here we stand today, 1 year later, Father, and we are in awe. Not only is there a new senior pastor, but now a new executive pastor, and we give you all praise and glory, Father. We thank you so much, Lord God, for Daryl and Jen, what they've already done here at our church, the service that they provide, the blessing that they are to us. We thank you for that. But Father, we thank you now for this new calling that you've given Daryl as our new executive pastor. Father, we ask that you would anoint him, and you would fill him with your spirit for this role that you selected him for, just as you anointed and filled David for his role, Lord. We pray that you would give him wisdom, you would give him boldness and courage and clarity to hear from you, Father. We thank you for their marriage, for Daryl and Jen. We pray you'd bless their marriage. We pray you'd protect them from the attacks of the enemy, Father. We pray that you would give them joy and peace in their home, Father, and grow their faith, Lord God. And Father, for us as a congregation, Lord, we ask that you would knit our hearts to our new executive pastor, Father, so that we may support him and follow well. In all of this, we give you praise and glory for your great provision. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
God bless you. You're dismissed. Hope you have a great day.